This episode of Earl Grey is brought to you by Audible.com, offering more than 180,000 titles for smartphone, tablet, and desktop. To get a free audiobook of your choice and help Trek FM at the same time, visit audibletrial.com/trekfm. And also by Enterprise in Space, an international program of the nonprofit National Space Society. Find out how you can help science and education and become a virtual crew member aboard the NSS Enterprise Orbiter by visiting enterpriseinspace.org.
This is Dwight Schultz. I played Reginald Barclay, otherwise known as Broccoli, on Star Trek Next Generation and Voyager. You're listening to Trek FM.
Earl Grey Hot.
Welcome to another cup of Earl Grey, Trek FM's dedicated podcast to the next generation. I'm your host, Justin Oser. Amy is away this week, and we do have a special guest that we will introduce later, but join with me today is the blown over by the wind in one direction, Joe Keegan. How you doing today?
Yeah, I'm good. Windswept and interesting as usual. Before we started recording, I mentioned to Justin that the UK was being battered by another Atlantic storm, so it's very windy, reports of 65-foot waves. My run this morning with the dogs was very interesting. So, yeah, but it's good to be here and excited to be talking about
AI. And that's what I was referring to. Like, you, the wind was at your back in one direction and the other direction. And you're just really hard to make any progress.
It was like being on a treadmill on the way home.
Yeah, well, so good that you're here with us despite all of that. Uh-huh. So let's start out with some Babel Conference feedback. This is for Earl Grey 311, which was Science and TNG with the amazing Dr. Aaron McDonald. So, Joe, you want to read the first one?
Yes, this was literally the most fun I've had podcasting. I think I like the science episodes because I know about science and it's relatively easy to talk about. But with another scientist on and somebody that is so as charismatic as Aaron, it was just a joy and a pleasure. So Michael Bentley says, just finished listening to this. Great educational discussion, and I wish I'd thought to post a question about holodecks. I know we have holograms, but making them solid in the way that Star Trek does, as well as completely convincing representations of people and landscape, I'd love to know if that might one day be possible. Thanks for your comment, Michael. That's a really good question. We have holograms, but I know we have VR, which is maybe a half a step down the line of eventually getting holodecks, but that physical representation using force fields and probably replicators and transporters to have food on the holodeck that doesn't disappear from your stomach when you leave is quite interesting. I'm sure we'll get there one day. Yeah. Star Trek's good for inventing things and then real scientists go and make it.
Yeah. Yeah, and then you can surround yourself with holograms that look like yourself and maybe have different accents and do what you want. So,
true, that's maybe so confusing. And if he didn't like it, why didn't he just delete it, the C-3PO one?
It's
the protocol droid that he's got.
I think in Picard it's really fun. But I thought it would just get a laugh out of you.
And I know I have moaned about Picard in the past because I'm struggling to get into it because I feel it's quite slow. I did enjoy episode 4 more than I've enjoyed the others. So there's progress being made. But however, one caveat with that, Dr. Girardi said that there's only 3 billion stars in the Milky Way.
3 billion. I think she was saying like 3 billion habitable planets, I think is what she meant. But anyway, we can split hairs over
She said
later.
Stars. I've listened to it like multiple times and
Let's keep talking about the
yes,
Babel
Conference
feedback.
That's why we're here, I suppose.
I thought I would throw in something that would get a laugh. But
I know, and then I went on a rant, so I'll teach you.
So we also have Guy Buttersnaps, who says, these are the episodes. I listen to Trek Trek.fm podcast to give me a better understanding and appreciation for Star Trek. I always thought I was alone until a few years ago. Thank you. So thank you for your comment. Just really appreciate that you're enjoying Trek FM podcasts and getting a better understanding and appreciation of Star Trek. I feel like that happens for me as well as we talk about these things and analyze things and hear from different perspectives, right?
That this is true. Yeah, but I really hope that is their real name. Because that sounds, if it's not, I feel that's the tastiest snack that anybody could ever invent. It's like all butter shortbread, you know, isn't made of just 100% butter because there's like flour and sugar in it. But ghee is clarified butter and butter snaps as well. So it's just like quite calorific, I would imagine. It's a snack. But thanks for your comment, Ghee. That's cool. Karen Chupla says, "This was so fun. I would love to see some kind of depiction of how gravity waves really work, what they do to local space, etc. I totally agree on don't explain it as much approach. Thinking about TOS, they rarely attempted to explain how a thing worked. Think communicators or tricorders. At the time, those had to seem completely impossible, and left up to the imagination, people in real life said, I need to figure out how to make that a real thing. One other thing I've rather liked are the depiction of insanely incomprehensible areas of space being thrown to areas that are so bizarre and anomalous, we think of them as practically fantasy. There must be areas like that where it seems like impossible things are happening. I hope there is more of that at some point." And that's a good point. Now that you mention that, the bizarre and anomalous, I'm always reminded me of Where No One Has Gone Before, where the Enterprise is hurled by the Traveller to weird and exotic galaxies. But I'm thinking what we know of the universe, the laws of physics are kind of universal. So galaxies and stars and planets, as far as we're concerned, all have formed in much the same way. So I don't know whether we'll see those kind of depictions in real space ever.
Yeah.
But it's an interesting topic.
More and find out. Yeah. Mm. Yeah. So we also have Mark Keller who says, "Dr. McDonald is a great guest. It's cool she uses science fiction to teach. I wish my science teachers were like that. Here's to having Dr. McDonald back in a future episode. There's so much that needs to be covered, like tricorders, the holodeck, time travel, etc. Joe Keegan does a good job of explaining things as well." So there you go. Praise for Dr. Aaron McDonald and for you and someone asking for her to be back sometime in the future. So I guess we'll see what we do.
Yes, I'm glad the praise was like added on at the end for me. I was like, I might as have to mention Joe. And thanks that I do a good job as well. So
yeah,
I'm so pleased, Mark. Thank you.
All right, so thanks so much for your Babel Conference feedback on that episode. So today, join with us is a special guest. It's Jenn Tifft of the Snap Trek podcast. So Jen, welcome back to Earl Grey.
Hi, thanks for having me back. I appreciate it. This is fun.
Yeah, it's great to have you back. So you were on Earl Grey 298, where Amy and you and I talked about Keiko. Joe wasn't on that, but he gave his feedback in the episode after that. But we definitely wanted to have you back, and I gave you a list of possible topics for this, and the one that you picked is AI and TNG. So I wanted to see if you could talk a little bit about why that one interested you to talk about today.
Yeah, I mean, obviously this has become more of an interesting topic now that we've seen what Picard has in store for us. But mm-hmm. I think specifically on TNG, they had a really interesting perspective on different types of AI, what it means to be sentient and in general, and also just what rights these different types of intelligences have. You know how TNG is. One of the great things about it is rights for everyone. And I think there's several episodes where they brought up different variations on that theme that are really, really fascinating.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, it's definitely relevant now. We'll probably talk about it a little bit as it relates to Picard. Yeah, I think there are certain like characters and episodes that we put together a list to talk about. I mean, of course, I think the first one we need to talk about is Data and his extended family, which now with Picard is even more extended, yes. Really. So let's start. I mean, we could talk about them as a whole or just start with Data, but let's kind of start with how Data and kind of Sung type androids are presented to us within TNG. So Jen, your thoughts on that?
How they're presented to us in general?
Yeah, I mean, because I think they could have gone some different ways as far as seeing androids, but there's a kind of a particular way that Data is presented there's maybe even a different way that someone like Lawler, Juliana Tainer is presented. So I'm just curious kind of what that says about the perspective there.
Yeah, I mean, because we are to assume that Data is, in fact, a sentient being, you know, with all all that comes with that. You know, he's not just a computer in the body that looks like a person, you know, it's not just the casing that makes it, you know, he's legitimately on the inside a not a human, but a a being with sentience. Yeah. I think as far as like Data versus Lore versus Juliana and everyone, you know, an evil twin is a trope that, you know, happens everywhere and in many different ways, but it becomes a very, it's very relevant when you're talking about AI in general, because that's one of the fears that quote unquote, you know, that in general people may have about AIs is the you know, it turning quote unquote evil or doing things with unintended consequences. I think looking at that through an evil twin trope lens is interesting. It you know, as it relates to AI in general.
Yeah. Okay. I mean, Joe, your thoughts?
Interestingly, I've never really seen Data as an AI. Yeah. Obviously, he is because he's been artificially created.
Yeah.
But I see him more as a human because he exemplifies everything good about humanity. Yes. If you were to say or pick a description for Data, AI or human, I would naturally go with human. I just don't see him as being mechanized in any way.
Because
I know he is, so.
Yeah. It's interesting that you feel that way because I feel like I'm always conscious that Data is an android because, you know, he looks different and he kind of acts different. I mean, I think it's a kind of a conscious choice. Like he has this kind of gold paint and it's meant to tell you like he's different in some way, right? As opposed to him looking completely human, which we see with in other places, like with Juliana Tainer and Lal and other things. So for Data, I think of him as an artificial intelligence, as an android, but that has these qualities we can relate to as humans and kind of his wish to be more human. I mean, I think we can even relate to that sometimes, like that we want to be more human or have more of what we would call humanity, right?
Be better versions of ourselves.
Right.
Yeah.
Something everyone strives for.
Yeah.
And I mean, just the decision to make Data a main character, right? Because, I mean, we'd seen androids in the original series, but it was just something that was happening that week that was interesting for the plot, right? But to make it something that you really dive into, who are they? Are they sentient? What do they care about, you know, as a being? And how do they react with other people? I think it was kind of like a very conscious decision to start almost from that innocent place to try to define what it means to be human. That's kind of how I think about it.
That's okay. I was just going to say, I mean, it's I kind of think of Data similarly as I do with, you know, obviously Spock is the comparison in TOS. But specifically with that, you know, Spock would always say, oh, I'm a Vulcan, I don't have emotions. And you would see that just wasn't true. You know, like you based on his actions, you knew that Spock had emotions. And the same with Data. Like Data says, oh, I'm not capable of love. But, you know, you see like how he is with Lal. You see, you know, and millions of other examples that he might not, quote unquote, feel love, but he loves. He knows he shows love.
He takes the actions that are indicative of love.
Exactly.
Right.
Exactly. Yeah.
But there's a question, like, how do you measure how much somebody loves you? What is the measure of love? And it's through your actions. And if his actions demonstrate that, then he might as well not feel that kind of whatever we describe, ask you guys to describe what love is. It's kind of hard to articulate sometimes. So I think it's all to do with your actions. And he does that. Mm-hmm. So he loves. He might not be able to kind of emote love, but he does it. Mm-hmm. So see, he's definitely human. Hands down, he's human.
I mean, he's definitely doing things we associate with being human. I mean, and it's clear the way that Brent Spiner plays Data, it's not meant to be just like completely like cold and calculating and mechanical, right? Data is more than that, but kind of somewhere in between just like pure machine that doesn't really kind of adjust to its surroundings or what's being said to it. It's just programmed a certain way in between that and a human being that's just like completely reacting to all the stuff that's happening. He kind of occupies this interesting middle space, it feels like. Like he's striving to be human and have all of that flexibility and feel the emotions and all of that, but it's difficult for him to get there. I think even when he gets to the emotion chip, it's not quite that, because it's almost like it's simulating that. I don't know, it's just hard to describe, but I feel like Data occupies this really interesting place between the two.
Yeah.
Does that make
sense?
No,
I agree. And like the emotion chip is more just like simulating your body's natural response to emotions versus like giving mm-hmm. him the emotions. You know what I mean? Like when you love someone and your heart, you know, your heart races or whatever, you know, whatever other physiological responses mm-hmm. your body has to that, mm-hmm. that's not, it's not giving you, you know, the emotion chip gives him that, not, oh, you will love this person, you know, kind of like, or you will, you know, so yeah. So I think the emotion chip's kind of incidental, more so to his yeah. journey to becoming human, I think, you know.
But in a way, how is that different from yeah. us? Because we have certain things that happen with our bodies or, you know, hormones or chemical right. interactions or whatever that make us feel that. And if Data is getting some facsimile of that, is it really different? Like, I don't know.
Yeah, we're just, humans are just biological computers. So we've got our own programming and it just happens to be genetic. And there's yeah, all I these mean, chemical interactions that happen in our brains that make us feel certain ways and give us the ability to be emotional beings. And if Data's emotion chip does the same thing, then I don't see it as being any different. I think Data is a bit like, a giant, really smart toddler sometimes. I mean, he struggles with kind of humanity and what it is to be human and his journey to be fully human, even though that's probably an unattainable goal. Yeah, I think he's a bit like a toddler in some respects.
I mean, you say that, but and in certain ways he is very innocent, but he's also doing very adult things, like, you know, fulfilling this role as the operations officer on the Enterprise, sometimes dealing with difficult command decisions and all of that. So he has sophistication about the world, especially yeah. as the seasons go on, but there's still something that is kind of where he's innocent and asking very almost naive questions. Like sometimes he's asking Geordi like basic questions that, you know, you feel like yes. you figured out as a kid, like, what do I do in this situation?
Like, what does Snoop mean? It's like, oh, come on, he's got a built-in dictionary. The Oxford English Dictionary version right. 5000, and it doesn't have Snoop in it. Come on.
Yeah, I think it's more meant to just emphasize that his experience is limited to certain things. But anyway, I just think that Data, the way that he is, maybe because he's a main character, is constructed in such a way that you really kind of feel for him and you really can relate to who he is. Because if it was just like some android with, you know, a blank stare and that just does what they says for seven seasons, like, that's not that interesting, right? Or maybe even if it's someone for seven seasons that's kind of indistinguishable from a human, maybe that wouldn't be... It's like the striving toward being something more and then getting to us relating to us striving to being more. That's kind of how I see it. I mean, there is Data, I think, that occupies this interesting place, but then we get, I mean, we talked about Lore, who's basically like an evil twin. So yeah, I don't know if there's too much more to say about Lore. And then B4 is kind of like really innocent, doesn't know much of what's going on. I think that some of the other examples that you see, like Lal, is really interesting because she looks human and seems to have emotions and has like a breakdown and can cry and all of that kind of stuff. So that's getting more toward being completely human. Like,
there's your toddler.
But
Jim.
I mean, what kind?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. And you throw her a ball and it goes by and she's like, wait. I missed it. You know, she's just like really learning the basics, right?
He's biting that female's face or whatever she says.
Yeah. And I mean, The Offspring is such a great and moving episode. But is it something where, you know, you see Lal, who's kind of like more human and has these emotions and it doesn't work out. Like, did it have to be the case that it didn't work out? Would it have been like, you know, if you had LOL going forward, I know TNG's more episodic, maybe you wouldn't have had that, but like, what would that have been like seeing someone go through that journey?
Brent Spiner would definitely have pushed to replace Spot with the actress that played LOL, because he hated working with that cat.
I didn't know that. That's kind of funny.
Yeah, he said the cat was really difficult. Yeah.
Yeah.
That's funny.
Well, the different cats. Yeah.
You don't have cats, Jen, do you?
No, I have a dog.
Oh, yeah. Okay. I've got dogs as well, yeah. So that's good. Yeah. I'm free to insult cats. Oh, no. Remember, I've told you this before. My one data point of cat experience is my friend's cat grown up, and it was the offspring of some kind of feral beast that lived in the mountain, and it was a vicious little thing. So ever since then, I've never liked cats.
I'm really impressed that in that same story, you put the word data and offspring. Very nice.
That's impressive.
That's what I did. That was just,
your programming.
Words that are in my kind of, I know it's my programming. I'm just, whatever words are in my frontal data bank, I suppose. Wow.
But if they did have, you were talking about having LOL and more than one episode, you know, and if it did, I think it would kind of more have the feel of the 7 of 9 doctor. The EMH relationship, because you have the EMH teaching Seven how to be more human, and he's not human either. And I it probably would have been a little bit of those kind of moments, you know, between Data and LOL, kind of investigating the, you know, different foibles of humanity together.
It could be, but I would see it almost like Data would be teaching her how to navigate this world as an android, because that is an experience he's had that he can impart, but can't really tell her how to be more human, I think, but
there would have to be an episode a bit like the Voyager episode where the Doctor gets a holodeck family and they're all this perfect 1950s kind of idealized housewife with a perfect blonde bob, and there's two kids that are the perfect ideal of what a child should be that go off to school and come home and do their homework
until they aren't.
Yes, until they get reprogrammed and they're kind of hanging out with Klingons and just throwing tantrums, and the wife's an alcoholic probably. So there would have to be an episode like that where Data has this new family. He's a single father, and he's struggling with what Lal's going through in that episode.
Yeah. So here's a question that I've always had. Like, they introduce Lal, who looks pretty much like a human. I mean, basically you can tell she's an android by some of the reactions and different things, but they kind of decided... And it's an interesting thing because, you know, at the start of TNG, you have Data, who you can see clearly, you know, has this gold face and like all these things where you can tell like, oh, he's an android. Whereas like in the original series, you had episodes where there were people that were androids that you didn't really know about for a while. And then they decided to kind of bring that into TNG, I think, with The Offspring, where Lal is, you know, pretty much looks on the outside like a human. And then you have that later with Juliana Tainer, and we're even getting some of that kind of stuff in Picard. So like, how does that kind of change how you feel about them? I mean, maybe for you, it doesn't, because you see Data as human anyway, but like, how does that change the experience seeing someone that is kind of different from Data in that way and really looks human and could, you know, in some cases even pass for being human? What is that? I mean, like, how do we feel about that and that kind of AI?
I mean, I was going to say, I mean, they do that on purpose now, try to make it more human-like to make you more comfortable with them. and I don't know if that...
But we were comfortable with Data for several seasons before, so...
But you could tell even in Picard, where they all the Maddox-type androids all look alike and look like androids too.
But they look super creepy.
Yeah, creepy and extra creepy when they try to try to be human with this, try to smile and and everything. But that's a choice.
And I mean, that's
and
it's an interesting distinction in Picard, because you have these like non-sentient androids that are doing this work, and then you have Daj and Soji, who are more I know listeners were going into card stuff, but hopefully you've seen the first episode by now. No, that's fine, because now I think about it as this whole thing, because it really relates to Data, and it was very much a contrast in Picard when you see these androids on Mars, and it's kind of like, you know, blank stare, not getting things, just like really machines to be used for certain things and not sentient at all. And yeah, and it's used as a certain element. But again, like if you had that like every episode as like a main character, it would be creepy or really disturbing. Like, I think it gets to something like, in order to relate to the characters, we need to feel like we relate to them in some way. Like if they're too alien or too different from our experience, it makes us uncomfortable. We think it's creepy or weird. Like, is that something we just can't get past?
There's that point on the spectrum of like being really alien and being like human. There's different points where things are comfortable. So if things are really alien, like spiders, or the spidery things from Starship Troopers, then they're really scary because we don't identify with them at all. Yeah, they have appendages and they've got eyes and they've got a body, but they look completely similar to being human. And then you get everything in between that we're kind of comfortable with. They don't look human, they don't look too alien like dogs and cats. We're okay with them. There's a point close to being human where things look just, it's not quite human and it's not quite animal, and it's more creepy than being fully alien. I'm thinking that the Japanese roboticist that made a robotic version of his daughter, and it has a fully human looking face, and it's got the black bobbed wig, and it looks human, but there's just something about it that completely lacks any humanity. And it's like, oh, why?
Right, what was something the motivation? Where you wouldn't see it and mistake it for an actual human, right?
Yes, but it's too close for comfort that it feels uncomfortable and a bit disconcerting.
I think that's pretty interesting.
What's creepy about that? Why? What scares us about that? I wonder, you know?
I think what can be really uncomfortable, like about the specific example that you're giving, Joe, is something that is like us, but missing something or not quite the same, so that we're afraid that it's going to do something that's unpredictable, something that we can't understand. Yeah, although, of course, as human beings, we see other human beings do things that are unpredictable, scary, unreasonable, whatever. But like, I think part of it is, you know, there's a certain spectrum of things that human beings do and are capable of, right? Mm-hmm. And I think from like the really amazing things to the really awful things, but we kind of know what that spectrum is. But I think there's something when you expand outside of that, beyond what a human can do, let's say an android that has, you know, super strength or can do things like so quickly you can't stop them, or may have some, you know, ambition to destroy your planet. I mean, some of those are extreme examples, but like, it's kind of like they're capable of doing things that it feels that humans cannot do. So it's like, makes us really like uncomfortable and a little frightened because it's outside of what we would normally expect, right? It like pushes the boundaries of potentially bad things, you know?
That's true. It's like up to the point we saw Daj fight in Picard, and she was just doing normal human fighting. Yes, she was very good at it, but like if I trained enough, I could probably do something not dissimilar. Yeah. But then she does the run and the leap.
And she just like leaps 50 like meters. 50 feet or something.
Yeah, and I'm like, oh, okay, I can do that no matter how far I tried. So there's that distinction where it's not quite human, so it might make you feel a bit uncomfortable.
Yeah, and I think too, it's the fear of the singularity, you know, I think I just read too much science fiction, but you know, the singularity when the AIs surpass us in intelligence and surpass us, you know, and if you see them doing something like you said, that's a strength or agility or things that we can't do. Mm-hmm. And then that next step, them doing things or becoming more intelligent than their creators. And, you know, then maybe the fear of something like what happened on Mars, you know, or them taking over the world, or, you know, so.
Yeah. Being afraid of what they might be capable of, that they've surpassed you, that you're not needed anymore. I think there are all of these kind of fears that come into that. And, you know, Data we can trust nearly always, right? But there are certain times where he's compromised, where you see that he could be really dangerous, right? If he has bad intentions or things that go against our Pyrrho characters. So,
just like any person can do. I mean, people can be brainwashed to do things just like an Android can be reprogrammed or hacked into.
But I do think some of it is that they can do things that are beyond what we can do. So it's kind of frightening. Like there's not a way to really combat that if it goes wrong. So
yeah, there's no fail safe if he gets hacked into.
So I think we're all agreeing that we have to build in some kind of Wi-Fi or Bluetooth kill switch that all humans have built into their phones.
If they get intelligent enough, they can bypass that. They'll know how to do it. They'll figure it out.
True.
but even the thought of that is a disturbing one, especially if you might get towards something that's sentient. Like, do you want to do that? Like, would you also do that for, you know, other humans that might maybe have a cybernetic implant that you'd want to put in a kill switch if they go wrong? Like, there's a lot of potential dangers to even thinking that way.
Ethical questions there that I know I'm not qualified to talk about, really. Answer.
Well, yeah, because that's it, too. It's different if data is, you know, a toaster, like they say in Measure of a Man. Is data a toaster or is data a person with rights? You know, right now
he doesn't have any slots in him for bread, so...
Exactly. No. So he's not like an appliance. But I think that's what she says, right? But, true. There's obviously two different sets of rules, you know? Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I think this is a really interesting discussion. Like always, I wasn't sure where it would lead, but I think there are a lot of important questions here about where AI is going and what direction it's going to go in, what are the limits of it. But I think we've talked about kind of data and his extended family for a while, but I think there's more to it as far as artificial intelligence goes in TNG. So I think one that we've highlighted here is Elementary Dear Data, and that, of course, Data's in it, but that's particularly for Moriarty, who is a hologram and seems to be granted sentience, right? And I think it's interesting to put in this category. I think it is artificial intelligence, although we usually think of like androids or robots as that, but I think sentient holograms would fit into that. Oh, yeah. What do you guys think?
Yeah, well, the Doctor from Voyager's definitely, I see him a bit like Data. I see him as being human because he is human, isn't he? Even though he's a hologram, he's not physical.
Yeah, and somebody like the Doctor is on Voyager is somebody that I forget sometimes that he's a hologram because he's interacting and doing these things. He doesn't look different than a human would. I do actually forget. Whereas like an Elementary Dear Data, which kind of really helped to inspire the Doctor later, I think you're very conscious that Moriarty is a hologram because he can't leave the holodeck, right?
Yeah.
But it's like for Data, he's somebody that can just kind of go out in the world and do things that others can do. So it's a question as he goes out in the world, what are his rights? But Moriarty is kind of like stuck in this prison of the holodeck and not getting out of it. So I've always found it kind of a little bit difficult to deal with because he's in a situation where... Like, through no fault of his own, he's been granted this, and he can't actually really do what he wants. So what are his rights, and what can he do? And at least as far as this episode, hey, maybe you could resurrect him later and give him a mobile emitter or something. But Jen, like, what do you think about, like, Moriarty and what we see of him and what that kind of says about this kind of AI?
Yeah, I'm going by the premise of the episode that we've proved he's sentient. Which I don't know if we actually have or not. You know, he could still be like what makes him sentient?
At the very least, he is acting in a manner consistent with that, even if it's like a a facsimile of that. He does seem to. I think in Measure of Man, like the different
criteria
for being sentient are intelligence, self-awareness, consciousness. And I don't know, Moriarty seems, I mean, he's definitely intelligent. He's definitely aware of himself. Yeah. It's the consciousness part that's difficult. Right. Like, what does that mean? What is that? Where does that, like, how does that work? That's the question I always have for him.
Yeah. But so assuming he meets all these criteria, you know, he's trapped in this prison. He's this conscious being trapped in this prison of the holodeck. And what do you do with that? Especially, like you said, there's no mobile emitter. There's no way to solve that problem for him. Just turning him off, ethical, you know, like they did. And apparently he could experience the passing of time and everything. And that seems like a cruelty to bestow on him. You know what I'm saying? So,
yeah.
And it seems like in the world of TNG, there's... there's certain rules for these kinds of things. They have AI in general seems to have certain rights. They seem to treat them in certain ways. But but this is even outside of that purview. So I don't think they knew what to do.
I would say rule number one of using the holodeck after this episode is don't ask for anything that can defeat data. It like really leads to bad consequences.
For some reason, that was the magic phrase that created the sentient being.
Well, and what does that say about the Enterprise computer that it can be given a command and create something that seems sentient? Like that kind of means that the Enterprise computer is a creator like Soong, right? Right? I mean, it's...
And we see that again in Emergence. Maybe we'll talk about that later.
Right?
Enterprise computer is pretty incredible.
It's interesting because I've never seen the Enterprise computer, any iteration of any Enterprise or any Starfleet vessel or even Deep Space Nine, as the computer system being artificially intelligent. It's just never appeared as...
There's a difference between artificial intelligence and sentience, right? We have artificial intelligence now, which means basically... like a program or network that can kind of learn from the interactions that it has and try to make intelligent decisions and adjust to things.
We have AIs that can pass Turing tests now, but they're not sentient. Mm. Right?
I didn't know we'd even gotten that far passing Turing tests. But like we have AI now, but I don't think anyone is arguing yet that any of the AI we have is sentient. But I think all of the Enterprise computers that we see, or all of the kind of Starship computers in the Federation, are artificially intelligent because they're kind of learning and reacting to situations on the fly, right? Because it's oftentimes like they'll give it a command the computer's never gotten before, and it'll be like, all right, I guess based on my past experience and what this person wants, I think they want this. Like it's very responsive and very much adjusting to all of the circumstances and everything that's being asked of it, right?
I think you might be right. I think I've got a... When I think naturally about artificial intelligence, I think about movies and books I've read where it's gone wrong, like 2001 A Space Odyssey and HAL goes crazy and kills everybody.
AI can be benevolent. I mean, it doesn't have to be bad.
Yeah, I just don't see any time you ask the Enterprise computer for something, it's a bit like Alexa or Siri just now, or Google, or I said Alexa and she's waiting for a question.
Alexa, are you sentient?
She can't hear.
Please rephrase the question.
Yeah. Although she probably said yes, and I'm going to kill you in your sleep. She's probably programmed.
Because she knows you will like to hear that. She's learning.
It's that kind of machine level learning where they get used to your preferences and they've got access to all your data that you put on the internet, and you've got accounts with Google and Apple and Amazon and everybody else, and they probably know you better than you know yourself, even though I get weird adverts on Facebook for things that, like female products that I'm never going to buy. So I don't know where this is going, but I think the point is that
sometimes the algorithm's off.
Yes, exactly. I don't see the Enterprise as being my version of artificial intelligence because it's very... you ask it something that gives you a response. It never really offers a discussion.
Yeah, it gives an example to that specific question. Mm-hmm. It's not like oh, here's the answer to your question, and you know, by the way, how's your day going? You know, like, I mean, you don't see that as much, at least from some of the computers that we've seen. But it is artificial intelligence in the way it's adjusting to things. Learning from things, I think.
I just think I also default to the sentient AI when I think of it also, just because that's where all the interesting questions and problems come. Because there's really no ethical dilemma with AIs that are, you know, that don't have that as much.
Yeah, that are behaving themselves and not trying to kill us. They're fine, they can stay. Right. Yeah.
We have other things to say about... Moriarty.
Yeah, I think the solution they came up with, you know, making him think that he busted out of the holodeck, I think that was a very it was a kindness to do to give to him.
Mm-hmm. To give them that experience. Yeah,
even though it was a lie, it was a kindness. I mean, kind of similar to what Data did with his mom. But it's weird because I agree with what they did at the end of the second Moriarty episode, but I disagree with what Data did at the end of that episode with his mom.
Oh yeah, so in Inheritance, where he didn't tell her, but I mean, but Data knew from Sung and like the holographic explanation that he gives that if she does know, basically she would shut down. So he's making the decision at that point that the best thing that he can do is just let her keep going with her life as it is, instead of effectively her life ending, right? I feel like in some ways it's the decision between killing her and letting her continue to live, even if it's under a lie.
I kind of thought of it like Bev's argument was that if she, you know, because this could happen in the future of her, you know, someone finding out, she could get into another accident and someone find out. It's and true. Then she, you know, Bev's argument was, I'd rather have found out from my son than from some random stranger about this.
Mm. Yeah, but you're taking the risk that what Noonien Sung put in there is going to work, yeah, and she's basically going to shut down and be dead. So,
but I don't know. I kind of feel like I would rather know. Well, because also he says, well, he programmed her to live for a long, nice long life and then shut down. I think like if I found out now, like if I put myself in that position, if I'm find out, oh, Jen, you're actually an android.
Jen, actually,
check my head here. I don't see any port stuff.
I do have something to tell you. So
do it, Justin. Do it, Justin. Yeah. It's maybe the shortest Earl Grey episode. The guest dies in front of us.
Smoke comes out of my ears. Yeah. But I'd rather be given that option to stay online and live forever versus, you know what I mean? Like,
you could just. But just think about that. Put yourself in Juliana Tainor's shoes, right? She thinks she is one thing and has thought that for a really long time. And all of a sudden, you're going to basically say, no, that's not true. Like, you are not who you think you are.
Yeah.
I mean, I think that would be a really difficult thing to deal with.
Oh, it's going
to
be right? beyond life-altering. Yeah.
If somebody came by tomorrow and said, you know what, you think you're a human being that was, you know, born here and had all of these experiences, but, you know, actually an advanced alien civilization, you know, created you in order to be the savior of Earth, and we need to tell your mission now. Like, I don't know what I would do, right? I would be like, well, first...
I'd be like, I've always known.
I suspected it.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah,
I knew I was special, but, you know.
I'd roll with it.
That's Justin.
It's a crazy example, no. But...
That's why I got my WoW signal tattoo. Do you remember the WoW signal tattoo? Then, what is it, 6EQUJ5? And it's like an alphanumeric...
Do you know about the WoW signal? Jen?
August 15th, 1977, the Big Ear radio telescope at Ohio State University detected that really powerful signal.
Yep.
And the printout, the dot matrix printout, and the guy saw it was really powerful, alphanumeric signal-to-noise ratio, 6EQUJ5, and they just called it WOW. And it happened on the day where I was born.
Oh, that's and awesome.
Yeah.
So you did. You know.
Yeah, that's why I got it tattooed. And I was like, that was the download of my celestial consciousness into
For
my
sure.
human body.
Sure.
It's so true.
I mean, it was never explained, so, yeah.
What is weirder is that three years before that, on the something like the 16th of November, 1974, we just refurbished the Arecibo Observatory in Puerto Rico and sent out the Arecibo message, which is that kind of two-dimensional QR code of information about humans and what we know and who we are and prime numbers. And that happened on the day my mum and dad got married.
Coincidence?
And I'm like, I'm putting all the data points together and forming a trend line, which means I'm like the universe's super being or something.
For sure.
Yeah, stay tuned for a future episode of Earl Grey where Joe finds out who he truly is and what his mission in this life really is.
And he just
is.
Turns into or a light. Big light being.
Yes, like
evolves to the next
stage. Yeah. Yes. Or some kind of the ceiling collapses and I get beamed. And I'm like, I just ascend in a beam of light. Or what happens is the alien invasion force come and then I turn into like a Dark Phoenix or something and go like up to space and save everybody with laser beams that come out of my eyes.
Talk about this today.
Justin, I've never got any idea what we're going to talk about.
It's
always a surprise.
All right. Conversation over. Joe is much more interesting than anything we're going to talk about today.
We're counting on you, Joe.
I'm here for his.
But I guess we need to keep going. So
I suppose, yeah. Downside, everything.
Yeah. Okay. So we've talked about data. We've talked about other kinds of androids. We've talked about holograms. We talked a little bit about the Enterprise computer. Maybe we'll talk more about that later. But one of the other things that's on here is evolution, which is where you see the nanites kind of having their own intelligence and society. And, you know, and it's interesting, like when we were putting together this list, I don't know if I'd specifically thought of the nanites as artificial intelligence, but I think that they kind of are, because they were, this happened because of Wesley's experiment. So it's like Wesley is kind of artificially creating this intelligence in a way.
But, or why did you have to say Wesley was God? That's the implication there.
I did not say that. I say he's the nanites.
He's the creator. He's the creator. I got small g.
they have a microscopic statue of Wesley that they carry along. Anyway, So Jen, like, what do you think of the nanites and the kind of artificial intelligence?
I'm fascinated by the idea of nanites in general. This is an interesting episode, but you're very right. This is an artificial intelligence that we have created, that a human has created. And there's something like nanobots or nanoprobes or whatever you want to call them are incredibly useful things, and it's not that far of a stretch to see how they could evolve into something like that. Like, this isn't really that much of a stretch as far as creating an artificial intelligence that might approach sentience, especially since they multiply so quickly, and it's really interesting. But this is the point of evolution, I think, is what is our, what do we owe this new intelligence that we created? Do we, you know, because it's easy to say, you know, when we talk about the androids, they can overpower us physically. When we talk about the nanites, I mean, they can control our computer systems, but, you know, we could step on them and kill them. You know what I mean? So does that change the dynamic? Should it? Should we just say, you know, like, should we, what they're going to do, irradiate them? And then that would be the end of that civilization. But we can't.
Yeah, they're definitely more vulnerable, right, because they're so small, but they do end up getting attention because they're affecting the ship so much. Right. I've always been really fascinated by the nanites as well, because, yeah, I mean, I think pretty much up until that point, when we'd seen in Star Trek some kind of artificial intelligence, it tended to be an android or hologram, like we said for Elementary Dear Data. But I think this was the first, well, that's not true actually, because one thing I didn't put on here, it's not an artificial intelligence, but it is a tiny intelligence, is the microbrains from Home Soil, because they're really small. So you'd see that. But something artificially created that's intelligent like that, I think this was kind of a new thing in Star Trek. And I always find it, like, really interesting, because, you know, you can see and interact with, you know, Data or an android or a hologram, and, you know, the size scale is similar. But when something's that small and there's so many of them, I mean, they find a way to communicate through Data, thankfully, but otherwise, like, if they didn't have that, or if they didn't have a universal translator, like, how would they even know, right? Like, it's an artificial intelligence you have to stumble upon. It's not just, like, right in front of you talking to you, self-aware. So I think it's a more difficult case. But Joe, what do you think of the nanites?
I really like nanotechnology in general. I think for us as humans just now, we're on the cusp of something really amazing with nanotech, where instead of having drugs for things that have side effects, we have nanites that go in and they'll use cancer cells to self-replicate. They'll just eat your tumor away, or they'll repair damage, or they'll eat the plaque that causes Alzheimer's in your brain, or fix all sorts of things, because we know how to build them at really small and we can control them wirelessly. And I think the difference between what we'll use as nanites and what the nanites in evolution have is this ability to network. So we get to the point where we can have little wireless antennae on our nanobots and allow them to communicate, and there's sufficient numbers of them and they're all communicating. They form some kind of,
it's like a neural network,
some kind of biological network, not biological but neural network, and then they become artificial intelligent. It's not much of a stretch.
And it's kind of like you're seeing their collective intelligence, right? You're not talking to like individual nanite Joe or Jen or something, right? Like you're talking to the nanites like as a group, whereas, you know, androids or a hologram, you're talking to someone one-on-one. So it is also kind of like this collective intelligence. I mean, in a way, like a smaller version of the Borg, in a way, like, because they're kind of like interacting with each other and sharing whatever, and like in a way, almost like the changelings in Deep Space Nine, where they're just kind of like pooling together what they think and then giving you some information or something. So I think there's something that's really interesting about it. But you know, there is the threat of them taking over the ship, but could there be another threat where, like, you talked about using like nanotechnology or nanobots, Joe, to like be injected into your body and to do certain things, but that could go wrong as well, right? Or be used for some malevolent intention or something like that. So they don't explore it in this episode, but I just think it's interesting. It's like a different, maybe, kind of threat.
Suppose it's like anything which is electronic, which you put in your body, it could be kind of hacked in some way. There was an episode of something, was it 24? It was some US political spy thing, and there was a senator, and he had some kind of pacemaker or some kind of device that keeps his heart ticking, but it had a code that it was kept in a cupboard in the White House or something, in a safe, and somebody broke in, stole it, and there was an assassination attempt on him because they got the code and they could basically switch off his pacemaker. So yeah, all this technology, it's going to, some bad guys out there will kind of have uses for it that aren't good.
That's true.
So
unintended consequences.
Yeah, with your point about I think nanites are the nanite brain that we spoke to. They were more than the sum of their parts, weren't they? But like, if me and my starship encountered one of your neurons out in space, Justin or Jen, I'm going to be like, yeah, it's not intelligent. But put your neuron back in your brain and kind of the whole network of neurons makes you intelligent, seemingly. Don't know who's measuring intelligence
just like
these days.
You know, a brain outside of your body or your heart outside of your body, does it make an intelligence to talk to? But when you have like all the stuff within you, then you are the sentient person, right? So maybe like the nanites, it's like that. They've gotten to a certain point that like the body's been constructed to be able to interact with. Yeah.
Yeah. So is it one consciousness, or
I don't know if they really say.
They don't really specify.
It's a bit like the Borg though. Is it one or is it many? Who you speak? Who's the Borg Queen? Yeah. What is it? How it confuses me.
Or is it one
and
many at the same time?
Yes. Is it like is it God and Jesus and the Holy Spirit? If you believe in God, do you mean they are different things, but they're the same? God and Jesus are the same person, and the Holy Spirit
is the same thing. Yeah.
Yes. It's, what did they call this? There's a name for that. Transubstantiation.
Trinity?
Or something. Something, it's a trans thing.
But I know what you mean. Like there is this whole, but you can still break it into certain components, right?
So it's kind of like a Voltron, you know, like the individual parts are still sentient beings, and put it together, it's a different thing, you know.
Voltron's on the tip of my.
Voltron. Oh, it's a cartoon from the 80s. It's basically all these little mechs together form a big mech, big robot.
Oh,
you know, but if
like
you,
when the power,
yeah, kind of like the
Power
Rangers.
When the Power Rangers join together.
Yeah.
Okay.
Kind of like the Power Rangers.
I get you. I don't know how I missed Voltron then.
Voltron. Yeah.
And I don't think I've ever seen it. I grew up in the 80s.
I'm maybe not as familiar with it, but do you mean as part of Transformers, or is that
a different thing?
Show that you're talking about.
Yeah, well, don't the Transformers do that too? Don't the Autobots come together?
I think so.
And make, one big thing. But, okay, never mind.
Yeah, all right, well.
But yeah, but it's like the Borg collectively is a consciousness, but then it's made of individual consciousness.
You can separate out individuals too.
So it's both, like you said. It's not just one.
The one and the many.
But the nanites might be similar. Who knows? The individual nanites are conscious.
Well,
talking about joining things together, my favorite ship in Star Trek Armada 2, the game, is where you get 8 tactical cubes and join them together to form a tactical fusion cube. And it's just this big, giant Borg cube.
That's
pretty cool. It's like, all you need is one ship and you can just go around and wipe out everybody. It's amazing.
Nice.
Joe's plan for next week. So another thing I think that we have on the list here that's also another episode I love is the quality of life with the exocomps, which are basically these tools. I think this is the maybe one thing on this list that's not really created by humans. It's created by this alien race that they're working with on this particle fountain thing that's mining from orbit. And I think it's Dr. Farallon, who's a Tyran, who has created these basically tools that can just kind of, they have, what do they call it, a micro transporter to kind of like bring into existence the different tools they need. Mm-hmm. They're cute. They have little feet. They fly.
They are cute.
But I mean, but like they're not tiny, 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 tiny like the nanites, and they're not looking like people, like androids that we see, but they seem like this tool. But in the course of the episode, we kind of find out that they really do have intelligence, self-awareness, maybe consciousness. I don't know. It's maybe a question if they're sentient, but Data thinks they really need to be kind of respected for who they are and given the choice for things. So I think this is an artificial intelligence that, like Moriarty, is kind of accidentally created. Mm-hmm. But Jen, what do you think of the exocomps?
Yeah, because it's an interesting dilemma too, because like you said, they don't resemble humans. We can't speak to them the way, or even the way we could with the nanites. It looks like our idea of a tool that we use for, you know, a million mm-hmm. different applications. And
so, like a toaster.
It's a toaster, exactly. Is this a toaster? Yeah. Is this a sentient being?
Yeah.
And
Exocomps 2.0 have slots on the side for toast. Right. Hopefully not.
Why not? I guess we have a replicator.
No, they just replicate like some kind of radiant heat source. Yeah. And just wave it over your bread and it toasts it.
Or maybe if
no slots required.
Maybe you set your phaser like at its lowest setting, you could toast some bread. Like, what's the lowest a phaser can do?
I would still use that.
I would use that too. Yeah. Just like, because I mean, you use it as a regular heat source sometimes to heat the mm-hmm. heat of the rocks, you know? Dial it back a little more. And
yeah. Did Sulu not do that in the original yeah. series when he was stuck on the planet and
to heat up right. the rocks?
Yeah. There was a storm going on. Well, I don't know why he didn't just use it to dig a cavern and dig a big hole in the ground and go inside it.
Oh, yeah. I guess if you could blast. That'd be. Yeah. Like, blast things with your phaser.
Yeah.
Yeah. Makeshift.
But Jen, sorry, I've gotten you off track okay. for
sorry. That was my fault.
Yeah. No, so it's, well, and then it's interesting because if you can't prove they're sentient, then should they have any rights at all? You know, like,
or should you give them the benefit of the
right,
doubt
do you have to
because
assume,
maybe they
do you have
are
to assume that
you
know, they are
and you don't want to trample right, on their rights. Right. Yeah.
But
which is kind of the place that they get to. It's like, well, we don't quite know what's going on here, but it does seem like there's self-awareness. We should give right. a choice, and you know, they really do end up making what seems like the best choice at the end, and one of them sacrifices themselves, which seems yes. to really say something about how they're right. thinking, right?
Yeah. And it's interesting too. The scientist just says, "Oh, they show signs of intelligence." And her response to that is, oh, yeah, when that happens, we just wipe their memory and start again. It's like, what? You don't think you might want to explore what's going on here?
Like, yeah, that's, I mean, it's an interesting thing in the episode because she's feeling the pressure of this project and wants to look past true. It. Maybe she knows mm-hmm. better, but she's like, people are expecting this thing to get done. Right. So, yeah.
I kind of see this episode a bit like a sequel to The Measure of a Man, where it was a question of life and sentience and rights. And it was, for us as Star Trek fans and people that love Data, because he's part of our family now, then that was a kind of a no-brainer. Right. It was an easy argument to win. But this, it was more tricky. Because, yeah, they showed signs of intelligence, but you weren't able to communicate with them in the same way. They didn't look human. They were just essentially toasters, weren't they, used for different purposes. And I think the question in the episode is, what is the spark of life? What caused them to spontaneously develop this level of intelligence to protect themselves from harm, which made it even more interesting than Measure of a Man, because it was kind of unanswerable.
And I mean, I think one thing that's really interesting is, yeah, it is a little harder to relate to them than Data, but the original concept would have gone even further and they would have been like a wall panel. Not even, I think, like moving around and doing stuff and having little feet that are cute.
Because they're kind of cute, yeah.
They are kind of cute, so yeah. You can relate to it on that level. But what if it was just like a panel? Yeah. It's just like sitting there. I think that was the idea. Like, how can you know for that, or how difficult would it be to accept that? I'll have to look up the information because yeah, I think that's what it was. It was just like, I think didn't want to go that
like
far.
Isn't the Voyager episode there? Isn't there one where there's a warhead that's sentient?
Yeah,
is the Cardassian?
Kind of is.
No, there's the one with the Cardassian warhead that ends up in the Delta Quadrant and wants to still fulfill its programming.
Yeah, yeah.
But there's also the one where the AI, there's a big AI metal missile.
Oh, yeah, maybe that's the one I'm thinking of. But yeah, but a wall panel would be even harder than the exocomps to relate to. They have to stick a little googly's eyes on them like they do with the robot in the grocery store. Yeah. Do you guys have that in your grocery stores? Here in our grocery stores, there's a robot that goes around. And it's pretty, it's like as tall as a person, but its job is to look.
It walks around in your store?
It walks around, it wheels around,
Jen,
and it looks
Jen,
for
spills. What year, and it what looks year for is spills. It where you are? No,
I'm serious. I'll send you guys a picture. But it wheels around, it looks for spills in the grocery aisles, and then it beeps, you know, so someone can come and clean up the spill. But they put little googly eyes on it.
I think Joe is horrified.
It is a little bit horrifying.
No, I'm going to find out where Jen lives and go live there. That sounds, I'm not convinced that Jen is currently in 2020. I think this transmission might be going through some kind of time crystal or some kind of interdimensional portal, and Jen's actually in 2145.
It could be. But they do the same thing. They try to make you relate to it. They give it a name tag, like the grocery store employees wear. His name is Marty, and he's got little googly. They put googly eyes on him.
Can you like talk to him?
I mean, he doesn't say anything. He just beeps. He just wheels around and looks for spills and beeps when there's a spill, basically. So. We don't have to worry about sentience with this one, but yeah, I'll send you a picture of him. He's kind of weird looking. But
that's so interesting.
But, yeah.
I feel for the poor human that lost a job because Marty was created.
Yeah.
There was a person that had a job to wipe up spills before.
Well, the people still need to wipe up the spills. He doesn't do that. He just alerts you to the spills.
He just alerts them.
What?
Yeah.
He's useless.
It does seem like a lot of trouble to go through.
Yeah, it seems like a quite expensive gimmick.
I think it's because if like you're in the store and there's a spill, you walk by it and you're like, they'll get to it. Somebody else will handle that. They're probably finding like nobody was telling them about spills and people were slipping and they were like, oh, we need to have a robot to do that.
If the spill sticks around long enough, someone's going to slip, I guess.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's so interesting. Although maybe they could have like really intelligent like cameras in the store that could pick up the spill instead of having someone going around.
Creepy robot.
You feel like thrown off my whole day here. Wow.
Don't know what to make of
it. Oh, my goodness.
I have to lie down.
I'll send you a picture.
Yeah, please.
It's like the last thing we expected today. Anyway.
You never know where the conversation
is
going to go.
So is Marty.
Marty, yeah.
Is Marty AI?
Yeah.
Has he showed any signs of intelligence yet?
He definitely is not self-aware, intelligent, or conscious. So we don't have to worry about giving him rights.
I really hope you're in the grocery store on the day where he goes, he just has had enough and says, you guys, shove your job, and like throws his uniform at a manager and then storms out the store.
Dude, I'd be all for it. I'd be like, Godspeed, Marty. Yeah. Go.
And he steals stuff on the way out.
He grabs like he grabs a bag of chips, like, and busts it open.
And a can of peaches. Yeah.
Oh my goodness.
Oh yeah, you have to video it if you see that. That'd be amazing.
Justice for Marty.
Oh yeah.
Hashtag free Marty.
Yeah.
Oh wow.
I feel like I want to start a protest.
All right. Well, let's keep going. So we talked about it a little bit, but Emergence. Yes. I think we put it on this list because. Something is happening in this episode where it seems like the Enterprise computer is trying to create some intelligence and figure some stuff out, and it flies out of the ship. So
I think you hit the nail on the head. Something is happening in this episode, and
I love this episode, Joe.
It's just weirder. It's weirder than a bag of cats.
It is weird.
You know what?
But in
it's so weird and out there, but in a good way. And I think it's a Minoski episode, and I like the Minoski episodes are just like so weird and out there. Masks is another one that I love, where it's like, this is bizarre, but I love it.
Yeah.
But
it's proper sci-fi, isn't it? It's like, who's the author? Who wrote The Algebraist? Ian M. Banks. And it's just like weird. It takes sci-fi to, it's like hard sci-fi. It's like highbrow sci-fi, and it takes you to the limits of your understanding and your perceptions of what the universe might be like and what might exist in it. But yeah, Masks and Emergence are just like, it's Star Trek. It's like, what is going on? Why?
Yeah, and it's pretty ambitious to try to visualize what an emerging consciousness would look like. You know, that's a pretty ambitious thing to do. So it's kind of interesting. I like how they did that. They put it on a train. They said, okay, well, he's taking pieces from all of our different, you know, programs, all of our different fantasies, you know, coming together. And it kind of puts together a little narrative like, oh, it makes sense. You know, they're trying to get somewhere on this train and they can't, you know, the different, you know, there's puzzles, there's, you know, bricks in a wall, there's all these different metaphors for building and it's, yeah. I really find it interesting the way they did it and the way they interact with the characters in the holodeck, the pieces of the consciousness that are trying to, you know, form. And it's really interesting.
I kind of love that with the different personalities on the train, but interesting little thing about it is they didn't have to build a new set for that. It was actually a reuse from a recent movie, Bram Stoker's Dracula. Oh. they were just like, oh, and it must have been a Paramount movie or something, like, oh, we have this train set and we need to reuse it. So they didn't have to actually build anything new. And I think some of the other stuff was like a New York City street set that Paramount
had. It's just always there.
Standing on the lot or whatever. That's always there. So they didn't have to actually build anything. Cool. But yeah, I think like it is one of those things where you're like, what would it look like if the Enterprise computer had an emerging intelligence within it? And they use the holodeck, they use these different characters, they're trying to put together this puzzle, and then the computer's figuring out, like, oh, I need these Verdion particles, where can I get that? I'll get those over here, and then create this whatever it is thing, right? This, like, glowing neon straw bendy thing that flies out into space. It's such an incredibly bizarre episode, but it gives you something really tangible in, like, the character interactions on the train to kind of understand what that is, because like in the other cases it's like, okay, androids in front of me, holograms in front of me, I can see the nanites under microscope or whatever, they can interact through data, the exocomps are right here, but for this it's like, it's the computer, like how do you depict that? I mean, it, like what would that even look like? But it's kind of like the computer is projecting out something and trying to figure it out, and I think that's really great. But I guess the question is, like, is it a sentient intelligence level that the computer gets to in this episode or creates or not?
Really,
it seems kind of unclear, right?
Unclear. But I think that's interesting too. I like that they decided off the bat that they were going to help the computer create this consciousness or this whatever it is.
Yeah.
And they make that decision. How do you know that's the right decision? How do you know this isn't going to be like some evil thing, like,
you wanted to see new life, there it sits being constructed in the cargo bay,
right?
You know,
like, and they make that part of their, you know, part of their missions, like, okay, they need Verdoron particles, we're gonna help you get to, you know, new Vertiform city or whatever they decided it's called, and we're gonna help you with that, we're gonna help you create this new life. And I just love that about Star Trek in general, like that's what they would decide to do without any debate. Like, there wasn't any debate about that, really, you know?
Yeah, it was just like, oh, we need to help this happen, instead of like, this might destroy us and we need to like kill it. But yeah, they're definitely like, I don't know, but let's give it the benefit of the doubt and see where it's going. Oh, it created it and it flew off and the computer's fine. Let's keep going. Everything's fine.
I'll chase after it, like, talk
but
to
like
it.
What is that thing? I mean, they're not going to like monitor this thing that's flown out or see what it's going to do. Maybe it wants to destroy a Federation colony. Like, they don't know. But yeah, it's very Star Trek what they do, where they're like, all right, let's just try to figure out what's going on, help it along, and just let it play out. But Joe, like, what do you think about what's happening in this episode? And is it some sentient intelligence or something? Or
I really don't know, Justin. I don't know.
It's just weird.
What was the genesis of the computer having to have an offspring, I suppose?
Didn't they pass some anomaly that or something like that? I'm trying to remember.
So something happened that caused the computer to make a new sentient life form, and it did that, and it looked a bit like a physical representation of an iOS 3D game where you have to put all the pipes in order of color.
It's funny because I was kind of looking back and I'm trying to remember if there was even an explanation or if it was kind of like the computer has learned enough things and gotten to enough level that it's just gotten to that point in its existence? Is that what's happening?
Yeah, and then you got to wonder about all the other ships. Like, they need to put out a bulletin.
Yeah.
Like, this might happen.
Case you're on the holodeck and all of a sudden you're almost run over by a train, then you need to really worry about what's
going on.
You
need to make the event report, you know, send it out to all the other ships.
So, yeah, I really don't know. And I think it's just that thing that Star Trek does. It'll, like, created this life form and it just goes out and does its thing. Or, like, the space jellyfish from Encounter at Farpoint. You never met them again. They just assumed that they were space-dwelling life forms and they went out. Or the things in the one with Leah Brahms.
You're talking about Galaxy's Child with the space ravioli? Yeah.
Yes.
That's how I think of them.
Yeah, all those things that are the Gormungandr in Discovery. There's just a lots of examples of life that exists out in space. And it's just going to do its own thing, and we shouldn't interfere with it.
Yeah, although a lot of those other examples, they're naturally in space. Like, I think the jellyfish or the Gormungandr, and this is artificially created. Like, does that even make sense? Because it's not created by, like, a humanoid being. It's created by the computer.
But we created the computer, like, so...
So it's artificially created.
Well, I mean, kind of like LOL is, right? Like, a human created data, and then data created LOL. It's kind of the same kind of thing. But they're artificial intelligence. Anyway,
I guess there's no organic component to it. Does that matter? Mm-hmm. I don't know.
Suppose do they, like what you see them do a lot of times? They'll put like a warning buoy on things or quarantine it, or they'll have tagged it in some way so Starfleet could monitor it in the future and see what it's up to. They're scientists and explorers, so they're going to see what it does and where it goes. And
you know what? I think it's going to be an important plot point in upcoming episode of Picard. They're just going to come up, oh, that's the thing that flew out of the Enterprise D like 25 years ago. Here it is again.
Just get references to every like one-off thing that happened in Next Gen.
Yeah. Oh, look, it's a star system where all of the stuff that flew out of the ship in 15 years has gathered. Let's check it out.
A little junkyard for all the weird stuff. I like that.
No, that's the ultimate nemesis. Basically, this little 3D colored pipe thing has been flying around collecting all the starship junk.
Ooh.
And it's creating some big super solar system sized robot that's going to come and get us all. Why did you abandon us?
Kind of like V'ger.
Oh my goodness.
Just that kind of thing.
Gotten like gigantic. Wow, that would be
the
crazy.
The only one that can defeat it is Picard and the La Siena crew.
Yeah, that would be interesting. Well,
excited.
In the very unlikely event that happens, you heard it here first. Yeah, let's keep going a little bit, because I think there was one thing that we put forward as kind of an honorable mention in this category, 11001001, which is the one with the binars who communicate to each other in binary language and are connected to their homeworld's computer system. Mm-hmm. So, Joe, I think, had you mentioned this one to put on the list?
Yeah, it just occurred to me that if they've got such an interconnected species through some kind of digital network, then undoubtedly they have to have some kind of artificial intelligence that's going to control that network on their homeworld. Something that's way more advanced than the Enterprise D computer. Even though the Enterprise D computer could store their homeworld's information. It's like, okay, that has to be a lot.
It's just that powerful. But like, actually... So you're thinking about it in terms of like the computer on the planet that has this control. I was thinking of it in terms of they've kind of upgraded themselves to an artificial intelligence in a way, or like an artificial like AI organic hybrid, because
like cybernetic.
Yeah, they're like bionic brains, basically.
They're communicating very naturally in like the language of binary code, and they're kind of like thinking about it that way, that an artificial intelligence like an android would. So I almost thought of it like the binars themselves are kind of like an AI organic hybrid. Is that weird to think of it that way?
I think, would they, I don't know, because they're obviously an organic species and they've evolved to the point technologically where they could incorporate electronics.
Yeah, that they have
themselves
they have cybernetic implants in their brain.
Yes, exactly.
So they are kind of like a hybrid
communication. And you can
imagine
kind
of like the Borg a little bit, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
But small and cute.
They're adorable.
Yeah.
Yeah. You'd imagine they've got some constant wireless subspace communication between them and their home world, and they're all kind of talking to each other. I don't know why I keep on waggling my fingers as like to show two-way communication. Listeners can't see me waggling my fingers. So
it's going very fast. It's a blur.
True. I know that's the lag in the subspace continuum. I don't think do they communicate still? Well, they communicate with us in English in the episode, but do they communicate?
They do.
With each other?
They communicate with each other in binary because you hear.
But you still hear them though. Is it them vocalizing it or is it through?
I think they vocalize it to each other.
But that would be really vocalizing binary communication would be really.
But if they're all connected, they should be able to do it telepathically.
You would think so, but maybe they have something about privacy within their own heads, and they just want to vocalize it instead.
Yeah.
But also in the real world, it just gives you something interesting to listen to and to see what they're doing. Mm-hmm. But
it just occurs to me that it'd be really inefficient to vocalize binary. So 011000011001.
It's a lot. They do it a lot faster than you do, though.
I just said hi.
Yeah.
Quite time consuming. I know they would have done it faster, but it would have made more sense for them to communicate wirelessly between their connected brains.
I could see
rather than vocalizing it.
And they're not scary. Are they not scary to us because they're cute? Because they're not scary.
I think so.
Because they should be scary. I mean, they do have a collective intelligence, like the Borg, and obviously they can get inside our heads enough to, you know, they created Riker's perfect woman. You know, like that's kind of scary that they could do that.
Is it exactly because they don't look human, but they look a little alien? Because I think we were talking about before, like one thing that's really scary is looking almost human, but like missing something subtle, right? But for them, they don't quite look human. They have, you know, what is it, like violet or purple skin or something, and they're just like
pinky purple.
They look a little different. And why is it that, I mean, they're kind of taking over the ship for their own means. Why aren't they as scary? Right. It's a good question.
Why don't they look scary? Is it because they've got big purple brains? I'm looking at a picture of them just now. Yeah, they've got big enlarged craniums. But I think what makes them less scary
is the Talosians have really large craniums, and I think they're kind of scary.
But they're quite tall, though. I think the diminutive stature of the binars makes them less intimidating.
So if they were like 10 feet tall, that would be a problem for walking down the corridors. But so tall is scary. Okay.
In the right circumstances, given context.
Yeah, tall AI.
And I guess, too, like the Talosians are using their mind powers to do nefarious things versus the binars just, you know, create a Riker, a perfect woman like this.
Yeah, and their ultimate goal is a benevolent one,
right?
Even if the way they go about it isn't the best. It's like, why didn't you tell us? We thought you would say no. It's like, oh, okay, fine. This is your way to do it. So, yeah, I think there's been like a really wide variety of things that we've talked about for AI, because it's not just androids, it's a lot of other stuff. But let's get some final thoughts on what we've talked about today, Jen.
No, yeah, I think I love that TNG has such a wide range of AI for us to talk about today. Like, it's really interesting to think about all the different ways that you can approach this topic and how they're even going in a different direction for Picard now, you know, and I'm very excited to see where that takes us, especially with, you know, who's controlling the Maddox type androids, you know. They didn't just decide to invade Mars on their own, so.
Joe, final thoughts?
And really interesting discussion again, and a discussion that kind of brought up more questions than answers. Again, but that's what's good about Star Trek, and it just highlights all the different versions of AI implementation that we saw. I agree, the whole Dash Soji thing, I'm kind of confused about how do you get a biological synth? What is that? How? I don't know.
I think we're going to find out more.
Yeah.
I interpret it as like flesh and blood, and then there's some neurons in there that make them AI, but yeah, it's a different kind of concept, because even for Juliana Tainer, like she was mechanical inside through and through, right? It was just on the outside she looked human. Yeah,
so that's a really interesting concept and not one that's ever occurred to me before. So it's kind of challenged my perception. So I think even though I've struggled with Picard, I will keep on watching it. Even if they make a billion episodes, I really want to see where they go with that.
So for my final thoughts, I mean, I think, you know, we've thought about this topic before. Jen, this has probably been on the list for a while now. But I think it's great to talk about this, very much timely, because it is an important part of Picard. I love that we talked about androids, you know, both ones like Data, where you can clearly see he's an android, and Lal and Juliana Tainer that are kind of more human. Talked about holograms and nanites and exocomps and, you know, an intelligence created by the Enterprise computer and a species that's connected to their homeworld's computer. So there's like a really great variety of these kinds of things. And I just love that, you know, when we look at it through this kind of lens and the conclusions we can draw, I think it leads to a lot of really important questions. And again, because we have artificial intelligence now, and we'll see where it goes, these are important questions that we need to think about, because we may be getting toward a place where we'll need to think about some of these things. Although I think it is a question whether you could actually have like an android or a hologram or something like that you can really consider to be sentient. It'll be interesting in the future if we'll know that in our lifetimes. Yeah. But yeah, I think they're really great questions. I think what they're doing, Picard, is really interesting. I've liked it, I think, a lot more than you have, Joe. But
I like it too. Sorry.
Yeah, but I've found it real interesting that they took this thing of, you know, an important character like Data and, you know, before and all that kind of stuff, and they're putting it forward in kind of a different kind of story that we're seeing unfold and how they'll deal with that. Now, also, we talked about Moriarty as a hologram. We've already seen some holograms in Picard. It's a question in my mind whether we get into that show, whether those are sentient or not. So I think that's an important question, whether they'll go there. And if they do, they're building on the foundation of what we've seen in TNG. So I think there's a lot of really great, relevant stuff here. And yeah, it's just lots of fun to talk about this.
Yeah.
So, Jen, it's been so great having you as a guest on again. So tell our listeners all the places they can find you online.
Yeah, thanks for having me. This has been great. You can find me on Twitter. I'm at EdetQuarks. And you can also find my podcast on Twitter. My podcast is SnapTrek, at SnapTrek. And we just recorded an episode. What we do is we take two episodes of Star Trek that are kind of tangentially related and you know, kind of pit them against each other in different categories. And we just recorded one that was Measure of a Man versus The Offspring. So it's a timely. Oh, we picked that before before it became relevant to Picard. So that one, one's coming out in soon. So. Yeah, so if you're interested, that's at SnapTrek on Twitter.
Yeah, listeners, definitely check that out. It's a great Thank podcast. You. I've been listening to the episode that you guys did on Day of the Dove versus yes. Battle Lines, which are, yeah, surprisingly similar. But yeah, just great to have you, and hope our listeners connect with you on Twitter and listen
Thank
to your
you.
SnapTrek podcast.
Thanks for having me.
Thanks so much.
Thanks, Jane.
Well, it's been so much fun talking with our guest, Jenn Tifft, about AI in TNG today, but that isn't the only thing we've been talking about here on the network. Here's what you might have missed elsewhere on Trek.fm.
Previously on Trek.fm, to the journey!
If I were writing Voyager right now, like reconceiving it, I would make each season like a different decade, like show the progression of time over 70 years.
See, we could have just done that with Kes as a character, though. I know I said it probably a million times in the last five episodes. Kes could have shown us what that would have been within the seven-year period. So, you know, we all know my opinions on Kes and how much I liked the character.
Earl Grey.
Okay, Amy, your ice pick.
What is that number?
Amy to the nth power pick.
I imagine it at the square root of minus one.
Negative one, yeah. Okay. Yeah, one.
Literary Treks.
You know, there's all this backstory as you're starting to learn in the show about what happened between Nemesis and the Picard show. And so there was all this backstory. You couldn't really show it all in the show. You don't want to. The show's about what's going on in the present time of the show. But, you know, Star Trek, since its origin, has always had ancillary materials that flesh out these stories. So, and we knew that would be the case here.
The Line, a Star Trek Picard podcast.
99% of the time, Star Trek tech makes sense. This does not to me.
Okay, Christy, like, Star Trek has asked me to believe some pretty ludicrous things. This takes
yeah.
the cake.
Okay.
I think so.
All right,
this
we're on the same page.
This is completely...
More than going warp 10 turns you into lizard?
More than lizard yeah. babies.
Really?
More than Spot turning into a baby lizard. This, I'm just like, what are you trying to feed me here?
That's interesting, because I believe this a lot more than those other things.
But. Yeah. Brandon Baga's evolution theories are much more believable than this.
No, they're really not. But yeah.
And that's what else is happening on Trek.fm.
Check out all these shows and join the conversation about your favorite corner of the Star Trek universe and beyond. You'll find us wherever you get your podcasts. If you're an Apple user, be sure to hit the subscribe button in Apple Podcasts on iPhone, iPad, or Apple TV, or the desktop Apple Podcasts app to get the latest details as soon as they are published. And please leave us a star rating and written review that helps others find the show.
Joe, you want a quick bonus question?
Oh, yes.
Yeah. So out of all the different types of artificial intelligence that we talked about today, which one would you like to see the most?
Oh, I'm kind of inclined to go with, I really want to say holograms, like because of the Doctor, because they would be like infinitely configurable. But I would really like a Soong type android kind of companion, kind of a data that just hangs about with me. That'd be cool. Like if you couldn't get the lid off a jar, you go, oh, data, could you... open that jar.
Okay.
What about you?
Yeah, it's just really interesting to think about what I would go with. I mean, I think the holograms would be really interesting, but it does get into question of if you can interact with them like that, are they sentient or not? I kind of think the exocomps are really friendly and useful, so I'd like to see them.
Yeah.
And treat them the way they should be and give them choices. So I guess I'd go with that.
Nice.
So if you're not an Apple user, we've got you covered as well. You can find our shows on Google Podcasts, Stitcher, TuneIn, Spreaker, SoundCloud, YouTube, and most third-party apps. And you can stream and download the MP3 file from our website or grab the RSS link.
We'd love to hear your thoughts on today's show, and there are many ways for you to do that. The best place to join in the larger conversation is the Babel Conference, our listeners group on Facebook. Just type Babel. B-A-B-E-L, into the search field on Facebook and it should come right up.
If you'd like to send us an email, you can use the form on our website at trek.fm/contact. Choose to send to a show and select Earl Grey. That will come right to us and we might read your email on the show. You can also find the network on Twitter and Instagram at Trek.fm and on Facebook at facebook.com/trek.fm. So Joe, where can people contact you when you're not working on your travel arrangements so that you can see Marty at a grocery store in Jen's area and free him from his servitude?
That's happening. Yeah, there'll be a nighttime raid on some grocery store in Philadelphia. And then video of me trying to smuggle a robot onto a commercial airliner. But when I'm not doing that, which isn't happening, law enforcement, if you're listening, then you can find me on the Babel Conference. You can tweet me on the Twitter at joyjoe77uk. Or you can email me at joepodcasts@gmail.com. Yeah, I forgot where you could get me there for a moment. And Justin, where can people contact you when you're not 100110110100110110?
Is that saying hello or is that something else?
I have no idea. I just made it up.
Okay.
I put ing at the end, implying that the binary sequence was a verb.
Okay.
Because so I know when what I'm not a verb verbing. Is now. Yeah,
yeah. I'm not verbing. You can find me elsewhere on the network co-hosting The Line. That's our Star Trek Picard podcast with my friends Chrissy DeClercq-Zalagi and Brandon Shea Matala. We're having a great time talking about every episode of Picard as it airs each week. Hopefully, listeners, you've been listening to that and think our long, in-depth conversations are interesting. You can also find me on Twitter. I'm at TrekFan4747, where I tweet about nothing but Star Trek. And you can find me hanging around the Babel Conference on Facebook.
If you'd like to help us keep all our shows coming to you each week, you can become a patron of the network on Patreon. Visit patreon.com/trekfm. That's patreon.com/trekfm to get all the details. Perks include early access to episodes, exclusive content, producer credits, and more, available through our special patrons website, Patron Zone. It requires a great deal of money to produce, host, and distribute these shows each month. We really appreciate any support you can give us and hope you'll join the team. Again, you'll find all the details at patreon.com/trekfm.
We'd like to take this opportunity to recognize our current associate producers, Norman Lau, Michael Hueter, Thomas Appel, Chris Tribuzio, Jim McMahon, Joe Keegan, and me, Justin Oser. Thank you for supporting Trek FM and especially Earl Grey. So join us next time for another cup of Earl Grey.
Free Marty, free Marty, free Marty.
Things are only impossible, such as freeing Marty, until they're not.
When we free Marty, free Marty, free Marty.
Marty, I hope you're listening.